Good afternoon, everyone. Today I'm going to present my honors project, which is about an analysis on Beethoven's Pastoral Sonata. So let me talk about some background of this sonata. This project will try to find out the characteristics of the piano music of the classical period by focusing on Piano Sonata No. 15 in D major, Opus 28 Pastoral by Beethoven. It is one of the piano sonatas written in at his Middle Ages, dedicated to a Viennese writer and secretary of an art academy, Count Joseph. The title Pastoral was not named by Beethoven himself. It is added by the score publisher in Hamburg. It is in accordance with the musical features of the sonata. All movements are in a unified style. It reflects Beethoven's feelings about the village and the scenery of nature. During 1801, when the sonata was composed, one of his students, Carl Czerny, started studying with him until 1803. In the same year, he also fell in love with a young countess called Julie Guicciardi. This sonata is published at the same time when his Moonlight Sonata, Opus 27, No. 2, was published. This reflects Beethoven's extremely contrasting emotions and a consolation after his fluctuating emotions. This sonata describes the tranquil and calm impression of the country's life. It was regarded as one of Beethoven's most delicate works. This sonata represents his change of composing after the Moonlight Sonata. It is peaceful and positive. This sonata reminds audience of his Pastoral Symphony, Opus 68, but the sonata is on a smaller scale. His music usually has great contrast in terms of melody, harmony, rhythm, and texture. Beethoven has a great contribution to the development of piano music. He was a transitionary composer between the classical period and romantic period. His early works usually follow the classical tradition while he began to change his musical style in his later works. He had a difficult life during his late years. We can see his innovative ideas on form and harmony in his later piano sonatas. His early piano works mostly do not require large hands, and the distance of notes mostly fit within the hand. As his music has a wide dynamic range, the pianist needs to have a high sensibility of tone color change. Beethoven expresses very extreme temperaments in his music. By studying the music of Beethoven, we can understand the main feature of piano works of the classical period. So, in the following, I will talk about the characteristics of classical piano music, and analysis of the four movements, the compositional techniques which Beethoven used, and encountered technical difficulties, and fingerings and performance tips. Beethoven is one of the composers who contributed a lot to the classical piano repertoire. Other composers in the same period also wrote piano music, including Mozart, Haydn, and Clementi. Their styles are greatly different in terms of character, dynamic contrast, and texture. The dynamic levels of Beethoven's music are very contrasting, which can be seen in many of his works besides piano music. Although amending many times, his handwriting is quite tidy. Beethoven's 32 piano sonatas are known as the New Testament of classical music. The Old Testament is Bach's well-tempered clavier. He is an important figure of the classical Viennese school. His piano music is one of his most important works and being performed widely nowadays. However, his piano works are the most confused, ambiguous, and mistaken in terms of addition. In terms of tempo, dynamics, phrasing, pedaling, and other important musical details, there are many misunderstandings do not correspond to the composer's original. original thoughts. Therefore, the earliest edition is useful to allow readers, piano students, teachers, and performers to understand the real and appropriate side of Beethoven. So, for the first movement, the first movement is elegant, which imitates the image of the pastoral. The bass note D is sustained for 20 bars until the change of bass note. The harmony is in the style of a string quartet, which takes ideas from other genres of music in piano writing. It is alterations between 1, 4, and 5 chords, with modulations from tonic to dominant. The voicing of chords is clear and open. It uses 9, 8, and 7, 6 suspensions to create tension and thirds to double the melody. In the first 8 bars are transposed up an octave higher. From bar 183 onwards, the melody and accompaniment alter between the higher register and the lower register, which produce a different timbre of sound. The accompaniment is a wavering scale pattern that is dynamic and also giving a sense of harmony. From bar 219 onwards, there are two melodies in contrary motion, sometimes in parallel motion, moving up and down between the register. Beethoven expanded a short motif into many bars by moving the melody as well as sustaining the chord. In the recapitulation, Beethoven extended the first part of the first theme by repeating the 1-4-5-5-7-1 progression. Now let's move on to the second movement. The second movement is dark, starting in the key of D minor. According to musicologist Rita Stablin, D minor is regarded as a key to dignity, divine, solemnity, and melancholy. It was used by many composers in different musical periods. Other famous examples in the key of D minor include Bach's Toccata and Fugue in D minor, BWV 565, and Chaconne Partita No. 2 for violin, which was written after the death of Bach's wife. The toccata is powerful and played by the organ, and also because of the full and rich minor chords. In the late Romantic period, many composers also used the key of D minor, such as Chopin's Prelude, Opus 28, No. 24 in D minor, Mendelssohn's Piano Trio No. 1 in D minor, and Schubert's Darmstadt from Schwanger. Until modern time, D minor is still a key frequently used by film composers. As Hans Zimmer, a famous film composer, said that it is his favorite key. He often starts composing on the key of D minor, which can create a broad and serious atmosphere. Famous examples include The Dark Knight, Pirates of the Caribbean, and the Da Vinci Code. This movement uses a lot of chromatic neighbor tones, which shows Beethoven's exploration of chromaticism. In bar 54, the difference between the first time is a rhythmic displacement, emphasizing the significance of the offbeat. The accompaniment is a broken chord form with some pedal point. The rhythm here is more compact and slower than the first movement. The triplets starting from bar 23 helps create forward motion. In the second half of this movement, the octaves thicken the overall texture as well as expanding the register. The parallel movement of two hands from bar 70 onwards reminds me of the polyphonic texture from the Baroque period. In bars 85 and 87, the inner voices move in contrary motion, which creates a subtle change in harmony. Until almost the end, the thick chords create more tension, especially the A7 flat 9 chord in bar 90, creating a minor 9th interval and a closed voicing. The final phrase moves slowly from top register to create an open voice. For the third movement, in this sonata, Beethoven expanded the classical three-movement form to four movements through the addition of a scherzo. It is short and in the structure of the ABA form. It reused materials from the first movement throughout the scherzo. It is in simple 3-4 time with a staccato fourth note figure on the first and second beat. The trio has a clear 4-bar phrase with a broken octave accompaniment which has appeared in the second movement. For the final movement, the rondo is repetitive, usually in the form of ABACA. It has a recurring theme A with several new materials in between. The main theme of this movement is an ascending line in the left hand with a short melody in the third and fourth bar. Beethoven makes slight alterations in later sections. The beginning of theme B is a brilliant broken chord passage with a descending bass line. Then three voices enter one after another from the top to the bottom like a fill. The ending is a stormy broken octave passage in unison. In theme C, the key is modulated sequentially. The melody is moved to the left hand during the second time. The music became more humorous with the use of staccatos later on. From bar 79 onwards, a three-part melody modulated to a minor key, which is the most technically difficult section. It requires precise coordination of bringing out specific voices by the pianist. More details will be explained in the chapter Encounter Technical Difficulties. This movement finally ends with a virtuosic coda. It represents many characteristics of the classical piano sonata, such as symmetric forms, phrases, and structure. Now let's talk about some compositional techniques. First, Beethoven uses sequence in this sonata. Many sequences are used throughout the first movement. They are generally displacements at different beats and ascending and descending figures. The second technique that Beethoven used is suspension and anticipation. A suspension means placing the original note later than it should be. For example, in bar 2, 5, and 6, the chord tones are delayed due to the 9, 8, and 7, 6 suspensions. Anticipation means placing the upcoming note earlier than it should be at. In bar 136, first movement, the first note of the phrase appears one beat earlier, which makes it more surprising to the listener and creates an offbeat feeling. The third compositional technique that Brinkman used is auxiliary notes. Starting from bar 177, first movement, both the melody and accompaniment became more chromatic. Beethoven did it by adding chromatic notes of the original scale in between to create leaps and a climbing effect. For encountered technical difficulties, there are mainly two aspects. The first being evenness of note values and the second, balance of chords. It is difficult to play every note on exact rhythm. To tackle this problem, I played by altering between long and short note values. First, I speed up from slow tempo using the metronome. Based on my own experience, for offbeat entrances such as in the fourth movement, to ensure clarity and evenness, I put an extra note on the onbeat for practice purpose to have a clear feel of the rhythm. After it is internalized to the memory and fingers, I remove the extra note and then it could be played comfortably. So it is hard to control the volume of different voice parts, meaning which part should be brought out more than others, especially sections in the first movement of playing outer voices using the fifth and inner voices using the first and second fingers. It is easily played inner voices louder than outer voices, but it should be played the opposite since the top note melody and bass notes are more important. To practice these sections, I played the four parts separately and then joined them back together to try out the best voices. The fingerings of D major scale and arpeggios can be applied to running passages in the first and fourth movements. For playing thirds, 1-3-2-4 is a suitable fingering. Pianists should be careful of turnings of the palm from 2-4 to 1-3 when going up the keys. Based on my own experience, to ensure smooth turnings when playing scales, the thumb should be already placed at the next key, under the other four fingers before passing down the key. Also, we should avoid as much unnecessary body movements as possible to not waste energy. Regarding the coda section of the final movement, while the right hand is playing running 16th, the left hand is playing an ascending octave pattern with the bass note remaining in between. Instead of moving directly left and right, the left hand should be relaxed and making a vertical U shape. Based on my own experience on increasing accuracy, the performer should be thinking about the bottom bass note rather than the moving ascending octave while practicing. When playing octaves, the pianist should feel the arm weight to play comfortably. Instead of only moving the wrist, the whole arm should be involved in the movement. The wrist, forearm, and shoulders should be relaxed, leading the movement of the palm to avoid overuse of fingers and injury. The elbow should have a suitable distance between the body to allow the hand to move freely. Last but not least, we should open up our ears to listen to any musical details and adjust it by playing differently. Also, we should focus on dynamics, entrances, and special changes, which is also helpful for understanding the piece. So now I'm going to perform the sonata. Thank you.